So, I'm very glad that you all are here to listen to me. And today I would like to give a talk about predicative generalizations of topos-like structures. If you need to ask some questions, you could interrupt me. And I hope to see the interruption. Okay. The main goal, the ultimate goal of this research, of the topic I'm going to present today, is a part of a project which uses the name topos in the Greek sense. To express the fact that I would like to find some categorical structures that can be used to model mathematics, constructive as a topos, but not only constructive, but also predicative. And not only predicative, but in a very strict sense, I mean to be able to found mathematics in a predicative way as put forward by Hermann Weyl in Das Continuum and by Solomon Pfefferman. And this means, in this talk, I will speak about the motivation in the first part, and then I will pass through the technical notions, and I hope to also to give examples, to explain a bit the examples. So, this talk could be placed in the field of a categorical logic. And it is a contribution to categorical model theory, in the sense that we want to apply the tools of category theory, in particular the tools put forward by Pillow-Villar with Dockrings, to model foundations for predicative and constructive mathematics. The ultimate goal is to establish independence proofs results as you do with model theory. And first thing to be noticed is that the usual notion of elementary topos as defined by Louvier-Tierney, is a categorical structure who enjoys an internal language, a logical language, which is impredicative in the sense of Russell and Poincaré, because there is a subobject classifier. And as usual, in the normal mathematics, this subobject classifier acts is enough to describe a power set. A power set of subsets, and this is a predicative as it is in the usual set theory found in mathematics, because you can define a subset like this of natural numbers, for example, which quantify over all subsets to define it, and this is what is called circular vicious. Because in order to define this subset, you need to know all the subset, including this set, to have just already defined all the subset, including this set. So this is actually a fixed point, and which is not solved, cannot be solved. And Russell said something is predicative, is a predicative definition. So if you define this, you give this definition, and you define something with variables, which whose entity you define is not, cannot be in the range of the variable. And I would like to stress that I would like to put a remedy to the categorical structure of a topos in order to avoid the predicativity of the power the subobject classifier. And not only that, because this research has already been initiated by other category theorists doing logic like Kemurdek and Benno van den Berg, and even before Eric Palton. But I want to go beyond their work, and I want to define a topos-like structure, let's say, accepted by classical predicative mathematics, because we see why. And I anticipate that most relevant predicative constructive foundations available in the literature are not adequate for this to become themselves, without nothing to do with category theory, but the foundation already in place in the literature. Most of the predicative and constructive foundations are not compatible with classical predicativity, namely classical logic added in a foundation, a realm, where power objects are not set. The power object of a set is not a set. And an exception is the minimalist foundation, which is a foundation which I designed together with Giovanni Sambin almost 10 years ago, more than that. And I want to stress the importance of this classical predicativity, because it go back to the beginning of the previous century, and simply because Hermann Weyl said that the continuums or real numbers cannot be battered into a single set of elements. So they cannot form a set. While rational numbers can form a set. And there is this fact that we need a foundation where real numbers to form a set, and only computable real numbers form a set. This idea was then formalized in a system which Hermann Weyl described in his book Das Continuum. And this system was formalized by Pfefferman, and Pfefferman and Simpson, the American Pfefferman and Simpson, put forward a program called Reverse Mathematics, in which they wanted to redo all the mathematics, the ordinary mathematics, within predicative foundation, and they succeeded. For most ordinary mathematics, classical one, it's possible to redo everything, let's say, all the mathematics that is taught at the university within a predicative foundation. So this project is not little thing that one could have application in ordinary mathematics. And the importance to be predicative and constructive instead is motivated by the fact that constructive mathematics bridges mathematics and computation. So whenever you have a constructive proof, you have actually a program to compute the possible existential witness of your proven existential statements, and you have that all the definable functions are computable. So it's important for me to be predicative and constructive, but also to be compatible with classical predicative mathematics. As usual in predicative mathematics and also in constructive mathematics, when you want to give a predicative analogous or version of a classical in predicative concept, you are faced with different choices. You have to face different options. You may have different possibilities. And this happens also in the work already started by proposing a predicative version of a topos. And however, for what regards toposes, we can see that there is a stop to my research, in the sense that no existing predicative generalization of a topos can be considered a foundation for classical predicative mathematics. So, reverse mathematics cannot be done in Boolean toposes. Why? Because Boolean predicative toposes are toposes, And this happens for all the known definition in the literature, including ours. And this means that toposes are not adequate to become foundations for classical predicative mathematics a la Pfefferman and Weil. They are usual mathematics in predicative one. So the one of the key points of my talk is to promote the importance of working in quasi-toposes, and not only quasi-toposes, but predicative quasi-toposes, because there are even more examples than toposes, and this is one of the key points of the talk, to explain why, actually. Already explained it, now we will go on. So, now, inadequate criteria. What do I mean by a predicative topos? I mean, or a predicative version of a topos. If I want to make a predicative version of something, I have to give a criteria, because not everything can be thought as a predicative version of a topos according to my opinion. And what I think as a version of a topos is something which has an internal language, which is predicative alla Russell, no vicious circles, sorry, I confused the names before, and is a generic language, can be thought to be equivalent, no, can be proved to be equivalent to that of the elementary topos, the original one, when you add a reducibility axiom alla Russell, or what is called nowadays in the field of type theory, a resizing rule. So it should be clear that you just basically declare a power object to be a set, or let's say a power of a set to be a set, and then you should have the original definition back. So very simple to be explained. And this notion should also have meaningful examples and given by relevant predicative foundations. The same criteria is not only for a topos, but can be put also for a quasi-topos, because the same, I say, if you want to give a predicative version of quasi-topos, you should define it, produce an internal language which is predicative alla Russell, and such that, again, you declare the power object we see are set, power object of a set is a set, recalling that in a quasi topos the power object classify only strong monomorphisms and not all monomorphisms, then you should add the usual internal language of a topos, so and this notion should predicative quasi topos should include relevant examples, predicative foundations. Hopefully, what? So, the fact that the power object of a set cannot be a set does not mean that we throw them away, which is what happened in some proposals of predicative topos, which I don't agree. And you just have to correct. To correct the structures by declaring the power object to be of a set, to be a collection or a class, not to be a set. And in the outcome, the way out to in general, from the logical point of view, is to adopt a concept from algebraic set theory, and within a categorical structure to distinguish sets from collection. The whole categorical structure will be a universal collection. Within it, we select sets, and also we have a proposition which would correspond to some objects, but not all necessarily. and like in the quasi-topos, and then you will have to declare something to be a small proposition when the proposition is quantifier over sex and not does not quantify over proper collection. And I start, I give it for granted that you know what is a topos, namely a finite and complete category with a finite complete Cartesian closed category with the classification of all with the omega, with the classifier of all subobjects, and you can start to generalize it in this way. For example, I give an example of a generalization which is not the perfect generalization for me, but would this generalization would satisfy the criteria that I gave at the beginning. And this simple notion of predicative generalized topos would consist of the following two categories: sets, on a category of sets, and the category of collection, as you have in the usual ordinary foundation of mathematics. You have collection what you call the classes, and then you could say that C, a category of classes, is a finitely complete category. Not more, because usual set theoretic foundation don't have more. And then you have that the category S is a category of sets, but we need to put in sets a smaller structure we can, in order that with the size in root to get a topos. And here we need to have a Cartesian closed category, because we should have certainly a Cartesian closed structure among sets, because the original topos would be that S, category of set, when collection coincides with sets. So at least we should have a Cartesian closed category, but we put much more. We put a locally Cartesian closed pretopos, and this is a type of subcategory. A locally Cartesian closed pretopos, which is a subcategory S of sets of C. And then there is an object omega, which lives in the category of collection, so it is not a set, which classifies the subobjects of S. And C is closed under exponentiation of omega, of omega over any element of, any set, any object of S. If we declare that the sizing rule to be the identification of sets with collection, so that in embedding is in an equivalence, then we would get back a topos. And what is not good of this definition is that its internal language is a bit strange if you try to do this, because because of the dependencies which does not fit well with the logic. It should be like a enriched.
Can I ask one question?
Yeah.
If S is a Cartesian closed category and I is the Yoneda embedding,
which
This would satisfy.
No, Yoneda. No, it's not Yoneda embedding. It's simply an embedding. Ah, you think if it would be. Yeah.
Yes, if I choose S to be Cartesian closed and I to be the Yoneda embedding, this would satisfy all the requests.
Aspetta, you need to put an LCC pretopos.
And then I start with S and LCC pretopos, and I take.
Yeah, but you need to classify the subobjects.
I can, in fact.
Yeah, I thought it would be an example.
Okay.
Yeah. And but the problem is that I care about the best example, because when we do predicative mathematics, we want to have the richest structure that we can in order to do whatever we want. If we are very small, we can do less. And so I propose my definition. In order to do this, to enrich this definition, I need to speak of vibrations. And I give for granted, you know, fabrications, and this particular other codomain fabrication of a category of another complete category. And what I say, this is a long definition, but because I have in mind a language. So basically I'm going from the logic where I designed what I want as a predicate topos, an eternal language of a predicate topos, what I desire as an eternal language of a predicate topos, and I go back in the category theory. And so it's the contrary here. So this that you will see, that I will explain, is a semantics of a dependent type theory, which I already written. And not written in the literature, but I have in mind. And so we say that a predicative generalized elementary topos is is a category, is a fabrication from S to C. So we fathered S over C. And so S would be a subcategory of the arrow category, because it should be I put in the third line. A fabrication should be a full subfabrication of the codomain fabrication on C. So S, it will be a subcategory, a full subcategory of the arrow category of C. So its object will be dependent sets. So we don't speak only of sets, but dependent sets. And we can have also dependent sets from our collection. This is very important. And the subobject doctrine associated to C should be a first order Lovia doctrine, something which I didn't say before. And C should be finite limits. And then, okay, I go on. Keep in mind that is a fabrication. Then it is a sub-fabrication of the codomain fabrication. Then I have to speak of fibers of this fibration. And the fibers on any collection of this fibration should be locally Cartesian closed pretopos. We get back a family of locally Cartesian closed pretopos, not only one, which would correspond here to the fiber over one in C, but we have a family of locally Cartesian closed pretopos. The substitution functor preserves the structure, and not only that, but the structure is preserved back in the fibers of the codomain fibration of the same object. And finally, I say that all the the full subcategory of the subobject the fibers of an object A, which are in the category of sets, which are families, let's say, are indexed, monomorphism, which are, describes a family of a small proposition, let's say, are classified by an object omega in C. And not only we have omega, which should represent the power object of one, but we can exponentiate this omega in the suitable slice category with any set index family on a collection A. So we are fibered the notion of topos because I want the maximum expressivity. If you find another version which satisfies the criteria that if I added a resizing rule, and the resizing rule in this case would be just simply that P of S is the codomain fabrication and satisfy all these properties, then you get a topos, elementary topos back, without any problem. And if you find another definition which satisfies the criteria, please write to me, tell me, because I'm very, very interested. And one can define an internal language of this notion, and this internal language, which I have clearly in my mind, because this is a kind of semantics of the language, I remind, modulo a splitting, okay? Because there are coherence issues to be addressed. Then I know that this internal language is predicative alla classe. And but unfortunately, I recall what I said before, that if you have that S coincide with the arrow category of C with all the properties, then you get back a tuple. The internal language of such things are can be formulated as a variation, an extension of an internal language of topos, which I put forward in my PhD thesis and then published much later in 2005, which is different from the internal language you find in the books about topos. In what it is different? Is this different because my internal language is dependent on theory of Lamarck-Loeff? Why Benabou language is a many-sorted logic? In fact, when you do the syntactic topos, in the case of the Benabou-Mitchell language, you have that the object are subsets and morphism are functional relations. Why? In my case, you have that the syntactic topos, as usual when you do an internal dependent IP or some structure, it is made of closed types, like sets, let's say, and type terms, like normal functions, operations in the logic language. So this denotes type terms, usual terms. And if I think of, I didn't explain the internal language of this predicative topo, but think of it, and then imagine that it exists. If you had this rule, which is very simple, any collection is a set, then you get back internal language of a topos. So it's very simple. The resizing rule or the so-called reducibility axiom gives back the internal language of a topos. I explained that this notion of predicative topos is not the unique one. It is the unique one which satisfies my criteria, but it's not the unique one in the literature. There are other notions in the literature which are called predicative topos. And actually in NLAB, there is a notion on which I don't agree, because it doesn't satisfy I started with the example. Do you see the slide or, okay. Why it's, do you see the slide?
I can also see.
Yeah. But basically there are three notions in the literature, or even more, four. But I say only three. Okay, there is one was put forward in PhD thesis by Benno van den Berg, which says that a predicative topos is simply a locally Cartesian closed p-topos with the founded trees. Okay, this notion doesn't follow my criteria, because there is no notion of collection, there is no resizing rule that you can put, because no matter in predicative or predicative you are, here you don't get a topos in any way. And moreover, we found the trees are not present in elementary topos. It is present in elementary topos with the international number logic. So we could give, don't consider a predicative version of elementary topos, but a one for elementary topos plus natural number object. But anyway, this is not correct, good for me. The second notion was put forward by, Ben Murdick and Palgrim. And it is, again, locally Cartesian closed topos with founded sets, plus a filtration of subcategories, so represent both maps, which interpret acts as a theory, which has a lot of things. And not a normal elementary topos is not an example of this, because, in fact, I forgot to say that in my criteria, a topos should be a predicative topos. Sì, nel senso that I'm not because it's predicative, but because the fact that I'm generalizing the notion of topos. So a topos, elementary topos, should be one of the examples. It's a predicative, but one of the examples. And ours, I just explained before. And examples, I go back to the examples. The examples for the predicative topos, which I just mentioned briefly, because I don't think I have time, eventually late in the end. Among the examples, there are the toposes, as I said before, instead of the notions by Mudek, Pilgrim, and Benno don't satisfy this first thing. And then genuine examples are one from homotopy theory, which I had to prove because in the book Homotopy Theory, there is the notion of predicative topos as the one by Benno van den Berg, a locally Cartesian closed topos, which is too little for me. And in order to say that the homotopy theory provide, in the homotopy theory we can have, we can select a predicative topos, I had to add some proofs, okay? So it's not in the book. And then you can make an example of predicative topos by as a syntactic category of Axel set theory, which was the one that Mudeik and Pager wanted to model and put within a predicative topos. Third example is important also because it's also, apart from homotopy theory, you can take Martin Löf type theory, both intentional and extensional, and make a so-called setoid model, which is a kind of Cauchy completion, a subcompletion, and there you can get again an example if you put the universes in the extensional type theory. And a fourth example is an example which I built with Samuele Maschio, which is a predicative version of Island effective topos, which is a predicative in a very strict sense, in the sense of Fermat. Okay, now I go on and I say that since I explained that all these predicative topos don't satisfy my goal, my original goal of my talk. Because since we are all based on local, somewhere, on locally Cartesian closed pre-topos, I don't put well-founded sets because this would be extra. What happens? In all the definitions, since there is a locally Cartesian pre-topos somewhere, you have that 1+1. If the locally Cartesian closed pre-topos is Boolean, as it is required by a Boolean predicate topos to be governed by classical logic, then you get that 1+1 classifies functional relations and then subobjects and classifies subobject defines as functional relation. And since in the top, in my predicative topos and also the other, in a locally Cartesian predicative topos, there exists a choice rule that a unique choice rule that is valid, then it is valid in any subcategory actually, this rule, then you get that with 1+1, you can classify all the subobjects. And 1+1 is bool, is a set, and so you get a topos. And there is no way. And actually, the validity of this, the exactness of the category, which is the validity of this rule of choice, is one of the ingredients of the predicative topos, because it has to be an exact category. So what happens? That this happens also for my definition, which we don't speak about. Okay. What happens? It happens that we need to a way out. What is the way out? The way out is the fact that we need to pass to quasi-topos. Because we know that the Boolean quasi-topos, first of all, first thing, which is not enough, but one observation, is that a Boolean quasi-topos is not necessarily a topos. And there are examples. Recall that quasi-topos is, I make it, made it here, quasi-topos, and I say here, if you don't remember, is a finitely complete, co-complete locally Cartesian closed category, for which there exists a classifier, not for all subobjects, but only for strong subobjects, or letter strong monomorphisms, which are those monomorphisms which are orthogonal to all epi of the category. And if you insert the classical logic among those, you don't get a topos, the classification remains strong monomorphism. So you don't, the classical logic doesn't mix with the structure too much. And this is the int. This is let's say a first observation. And then this is our conjecture, which hasn't proved yet, but I'm very confident that it can be proved. I want, as I did, define a predicative quasi-topos such that the Boolean version of this Boolean predicative quasi-topos is not a topos. Okay, fair enough. It remains predicative, so its internal language, which I have in mind, remains predicative even if when you add the excluded middle. So the excluded middle doesn't make an explosion to impredicativity, which through the rule of unique choice, because it will be compositional with respect to this notion. So the excluded middle does nothing anything to do with predicativity, but if you put in a context like a topos, a predicative topos, it explodes into impredicativity, which is a phenomenon which I haven't yet understood completely. Why things which apparently is nothing to do with impredicativity makes everything impredicative. It's a mystery of the excluded middle. And what I'm going to do is to actually define the predicative version of an arithmetic quasi-topos, because here, as in the topos, it would be difficult to get a predicative quasi-topos which it does not have a natural number object. The reason is that we could do it, but I don't want to do it because the addition of the natural number to the quasi-topos allows me to recover finite coequalizer from quotients, effective quotients, which can be expressed logically or type theoretically very well. So I speak of quasi-topos of a natural number object called arithmetic quasi-topos, and I speak of a predicative version of that. I'm confident that it's possible to do it a predicative version for quasi-topos, but its internal language is not nice, okay? But it would be impossible because we can express coequalizer in terms of type theory. This is the only point which is different. Instead, if you have a natural number object, you have a list object, and then you can reduce with quotient of equivalence relation, effective equivalence relation, you can define coequalizer for all any coequalizer in the category. Okay, so first I give the definition of predicative quasi-topos because I don't have enough much time left. And what is it? Again, it's a variation of the previous one. But I need to speak about not only of the codomain fibration, I need to speak about, given a finitely complete category, to speak about the full subcategory of the arrow category of monomorphisms, whose objects are monomorphism, and then the arrows are squares, commutative squares. And I speak of the pi monomorphism C, which is the restriction of the codomain fibration monomorphism, or the arrow categories of monomorphism. And now I give the definition. This is, again, this definition is a semantics of a very specified internal language of the internal dependent theory, which is already published in the literature. And namely, it is the extensional level of the minimalist foundation. So the minimalist foundation I mentioned a while ago is my notion of predicative topo, the internal language, sorry, internal language of the extensional level of my foundation should be the internal language of the notion of predicative topos, which that's why you see many things. And it will be future work to try to put this in a more elegant way and maybe more synthetic way. Okay, so a predicative generalized arithmetic quasi topos, I'm talking about arithmetic quasi topos because I include a natural number object, is a tuple where you have a category C of collection and three fabrication, one fabrication for sets, one fabrication for proposition, and one fabrication for small proposition. I heavily used the concept by Ike, Murdek, and Joyal on algebraic set theory, but I adapt them not by defining small maps as a bunch of axioms, but by speaking about the fabrication because it's closer to the semantics of type theory. It's modular and more elegant, in my opinion. More complicated to explain, but more elegant. And so, predicative quasi topos is done of this fabrication. There is the codomain fabrication, which is the one put on C, and then we have all full sub fabrication. Preserving Cartesian the embedding preserves Cartesian morphisms, and they are full. So we are talking about the change of the objects and their categories. And we have, I speak of ZR set because in principle I would like to have an index category, but I don't require it because otherwise examples run away and only syntactic examples remain. And there are three fabrications that I have to explain. One of sets, one of proposition, and one of small proposition. And just observe that the fabrication of small proposition is including proposition, so small proposition are proposition. And small proposition are also family of sets. While proposition are not necessary because they are just embedding in the codomain category of collection. And sets are not necessarily monomorphism. The fabrication of sets as fibers, which are simple arrow going into eventually a collection, and are family of sets index on a collection. And then what I said, so now I speak a bit, but I give the I don't read all the definition because it's a categorical semantics. And but the idea is that for any object, for any collection, the fiber of the fibration of proposition is is collapse, Posetta collapse is a usual first order hyperdoctrine. So it validates intuitionistic logic with the quantifier for all and there exists, and equality. The equality is given by the equalizer of two terms. And the quality in the fiber coincides with the quality in the base category. It has to be like that because the internal language I'm going to model is an extension of dependent type theory for who can know it. I'm very close, I have 2 minutes. So the fibration of sets, the fibers, again, are they are not pretoposes, otherwise you are get back the excluded middle when you are Boolean, are extensive low Cartesian categories. And they are closed under some quotients, normally only those quotients that comes from small proposition. And the fibration of small proposition is the one which whose Posetta reflection satisfies intuitionistic logic, but not first order logic. Only the quantifiers, it is closed under quantification only when the map on which you quantify, only if you quantify over sets. This is a generalization because I had the notion of sets, a family of sets. There is a natural number object in collection, which is also a set, is in the fiber of one. And then there is a classifier of the fibers of small proposition, which is an omega, which belongs to a collection. And we can exponentiate it over a family of sets, index on A, because we have fibered everything here. in order to have a very nice internal language. The internal language of such a structure is the extensional level of the minimalist foundation, so you can find it in the literature 10 years, published 10 years ago. And then the conjecture, where is it? The conjecture and is that when I add the discrete middle to this notion, I get back a theory, which is internal language is my theory, plus discrete middle, which is still predicative alla Fermat. And I think I've almost finished. I wanted to talk about the tripos and predicative triposes. But I don't have time, and more in another talk. And as a future work, I would like to provide a predicative tripos to topos completion, provide a predicative tripos to quasi-topos completion, and prove the conjecture, the main conjecture, namely that if I add a scooted middle to this quasi-topos, predicative quasi-topos, is internal language, is predicative, it can be used for reverse mathematics. I just want to say that in joint work with Fabio Pasquali and Pino Rosolini, we developed a quasi-topos completion of a tripos, which is very important because it's the only way to produce not only predicative quasi-toposes, and many examples come from that construction, but also to produce predicative topos, because the exact on-reg completion, the completion of a regular category and as an exact category, doesn't work predicatively. So only elementary quotient completion, as we put forward by myself, Pino Rosolini, and later with Fabio Pasquali, it's working to produce models of predicative toposes and of quasi-toposes. Okay, I think I finished in time, hopefully, no, maybe 2 minutes less, more, and more in another talk about triposes predicative, from a predicative point of view. Thank you very much for listening to me.
All right. Thank you very much for your nice talk. And I want to just take 2 minutes to, first of all, apologize again for the technical issues that we've had. I'm sure this won't happen again. And also I want to thank all those who joined later during the talk. And I also want to remind you that this is part of a bigger project, which is the Ithaca project, which aims at bringing together Italian category theorists by organizing events, and also so both in person when this will be possible again, and online events such as this Ithaca Fest that we're organizing. And the other people involved in this are Fosco Loregian, Beppe Metere, Ivan Di Liberti, and also Daniele is helping us with the website, so I want to thank all these people. And I also want to remind you that there is a there's a website for this. It's enough to just type Ithaca Fest, and you can find all the informations about the next installments for this event, and also info on the past talks. We also have a Facebook group that you can join. Just look for Ithaca on Facebook. And I see that Fosco just posted the website. And if you have any questions, just send us an email, and we can solve that. Okay. The last thing before introducing our next speaker is that there is a possibility of to chat after the second talk for those who want. And depending on the numbers, we will see if we just remain on this main channel or if we create separate rooms to simplify the communication.
Excuse me, but questions are not allowed.
Yeah. I'll also allow time for that, of course. Sorry. It's just not to forget these things that I wanted to say. Okay, so yeah, this is everything from me, and now whoever has a question, please ask.
I have one question, which is maybe a bit provocatory. So the notion of quasi-topos never convinced me, even in the Grothendieck version, even in the most trivial version in some sense, so forgetting about any kind of predicativity. Do you have some examples of quasi-topoi that look naturally in, and that are natural objects to study?
Yeah, for example, the equilogical spaces of Dana Scott, that is a very good category because it is Cartesian closed. You know that the category of topological space is not Cartesian closed. It's not weakly Cartesian closed. And if you want to approximate it, you need to do it, you can do it either by putting an exact on lex completion or by doing the equilogical, the quasi-topos. And there are many, many different, I like a lot of quasi-toposes, not only from the predicative point of view, because they are the only things that we can do predicatively with the function space, basically. And there is, for example, if you take a localic topos, is sitting always within a quasi-topos. And the quasi-topos is what remains if you want to do topology predicatively. You don't regain the you, unless you add a principle or something in the meta-theory, you don't regain it. So there are quasi-toposes everywhere. And even more, if you take a topos, a predicative topos, or a topos, and you do the exact elementary quotient completion of it as a tripos, so you take it, you get a quasi topos. You don't get back a topos. Because with Pino Rosolini, we have also with Fabio later, we have the principle characterizing what topos is. The elementary quotient completion of a tripos is a topos, and only if you have a choice principle in the tripos at the beginning, which are very rare.
Thank you. That's a very good answer to my question. Thank you.
I think that the quasi topos structure is more fundamental, and for example, in the effective topos. There is the assemblies, which is a quasi-topos, which explain very well the structure, what happens in the effective topos. It's very important, yeah.
I have a question.
Very good for your question, by the way. What's the name? Ivan. Yeah.
May I have it?
Yes, Pino, please. Yeah.
No, thank you very much, Millie. It was a very nice presentation. This is just to make sure the Pfefferman-Simpson approach to predicativity, does it fit within your final proposal? Do you know that or do you hope that?
I hope, because the proof which I have in mind is not published and not proof checked by proof theorist. I already have a proof. Actually, it goes via an elementary quotient completion, because elementary quotient completion are ubiquitous in realizability and in producing models of set theories. There are everywhere. When you do a realizability for CZF, for ICF, or so on, you do usually elementary quotient completion of the classical logic of a sum structure. And by using knowing the elementary quotient completion, I'm almost there to produce this. It will be, but it is not published, so I have to proof check it with the other people. So it's important to take care of the induction principles. But for rest, it will be possible. Yeah. It's a killer application of the minimalist foundation to be compatible with the Pfefferman's and Pryce. Project. And one thing is that real numbers don't form a set, only even classically in the minimalist foundation. But I have to still to prove it by using the effective topos.
I'm looking forward to seeing you as an assassin. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Other questions? Okay, if there are no more questions, I want to thank Millie again for the talk. And I guess I can introduce our next speaker for the day.